Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Join us in our gathering hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Jerusalem, and the first thing that he needs is a donkey, and he doesn't have one. So he asked a couple of friends of him to go into town and to get a donkey for him. So they're going to help him. So they have to go in and borrow it from somebody. And so they see a donkey at some house just tied up, and they start to get it, and the owner of the donkey starts saying, "Hey, what are you doing? That's my donkey." And they say to him, "Well, our Lord needs it, and we'll give it back to you real soon." And the owner said, "Okay." Now, we don't know who the people were that owned the donkey. The Bible doesn't tell us their names. And we don't know if they were friends of Jesus or if Jesus even knew them. We only know two things about them. First, they owned a donkey, and second, they said yes. And because they said yes, Jesus got to ride their donkey into Jerusalem. You see, it's good to help people. And I think during this time, when we have to stay home or there's a lot of people that need help, it's good to help each other. Just like the owner, let Jesus borrow their donkey, and they helped him out. So I want you guys to think about helping people this week, either mom or dad or some of your brothers or sisters. Just help out and do things around the house that you can do, and just show your love for them. The other thing I want you to do is, since you didn't get to be here today, I want you to act out this story with your family. So, first of all, you could probably be Jesus riding the donkey, but then you gotta find somebody who's the donkey. So mom, dad, grandma, big brother, big sister, somebody can be the donkey, and everybody else is waving like branches and saying, Hosanna, Hosanna. So I want you to do that today, and then once you do that, I want you to post it on Maple Grove Lutheran Church Facebook page, who was the donkey? Because I'd like to know who all the donkeys were today. So you guys have a great week, and be good and be kind to each other. We now rise for the gospel lesson.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately. This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, who is this? The crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He said to them, it is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he cured them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the amazing things he did and heard the children crying out in the temple, Hosanna to the Son of David. They became angry and said to him, do you hear what these are saying? Jesus said to them, yes. Have you never read? Out of the mouths of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise for yourself. Jesus left them, went out of the city to Bethany, and spent the night there. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. May mercy, grace, and peace be yours in abundance through God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Out of the mouths of babes. Jesus quotes Psalm 8, verse 2 to his detractors in the temple. It's an expression of how kids say the darndest things. Kids do call it like they see it. So to lighten our hearts a bit today, I culled a few of those kid sayings off the web. Dad says, "Come on, you guys are late." Child answers, "You should have started yelling at us earlier." Child, "What did I earn for being good today?" Mom, "My love and affection." Child, wailing, "I don't want that." Child, "I'm not cheating. I'm only helping myself to win." Father to daughter, "I love you." Daughter to father, "I love me too." Here's one for all you students studying online. Child, "I'm just not feeling very worky today." One more. Child, "You can make a wish, but then you have to do the wish. It doesn't just happen." A wish doesn't just happen. Hopes ran high each Passover in Jerusalem that the Messiah would come to save his people. In Palm Sunday sermons, Jesus' triumphal ride into the holy city usually takes center stage. Jesus is cheered by the crowds with honorific titles, Son of David, and the one who comes to save us. But what would that deliverance be? Many hoped the Messiah would save his people from the Romans. But Jesus didn't march up to Pilate's praetorium. Matthew tells us that the Lord went straight to the temple. And that's where our answers begin to take shape. We've posted an illustration of the temple floor plan on our website worship page where you found the order of worship and music for today's service. The gospel comes alive. It comes to life when you look at that plan. There was an outer courtyard, the court of the Gentiles. And over at Passover, it was a flea market of money changers and sellers of animals for sacrifice. Next, the women's court, and further in the men's court. Beyond still, the court of the priests, and then the sanctuary, which was separated by a long, ornate curtain from the Holy of Holies, the place where God dwelled, the connection between heaven and earth. Once a year, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest entered the Holy of Holies to offer the blood of sacrifice and incense. Jesus' first stop was the court of the Gentiles. Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple, and he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be a house of prayer,' but you are making it a den of robbers." On face value, we take it that Jesus was angry at the money changers and the sellers, though people were expected to make sacrifices, so a necessary service was performed. But especially for the largest festival of Passover, it's likely there was profiteering going on, and no doubt Jesus was angry at such a scene. But this was just the start of what Jesus came to do. To understand more fully his righteous anger, we're going to look at the prophecies of Jeremiah and Isaiah, which Jesus quotes. In Jeremiah chapter 7, God rails against the people's hypocrisy. Listen. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah, you that enter these gates to worship the Lord. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, make offerings to Baal, and go after other gods that you have not known, and then come and stand before me in this house which is called by my name, and say, we are safe, only to go on doing all these abominations? Has this house which is called by my name become a den of robbers in your sight? I am watching, says the Lord." It seems in Jeremiah's day, the people treated the temple like a magic charm against all their enemies, while they then turned around and committed what was evil in God's sight. And so Jesus is extending this same critique to anyone who worships in form but not substance. I remember we did a sermon series based on a book, The Christian Atheist, calling yourself a Christian but not living like one. That's something for all of us to remember, that our worship of God be expressed each day by the way we live. Next is the phrase house of prayer, which is found in Isaiah chapter 56, where God emphatically states his temple is open to all and any who call on his name. "I will bring them to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel." And that's just what Jesus did next. He gathers the outcasts and brings them in. The blind and the lame came to Jesus in the temple, and he cured them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the amazing things that he did and heard the children of the temple crying out, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they became angry. Why would anyone be angry at a miracle of healing? Why get upset about children singing? The holiness code from the Old Testament was likely the reason for their indignation. The law of Moses laid a heavy stigma on those with disabilities, labeling them unclean and prohibiting them from entering the temple. We know from a story in Acts of the Apostles chapter 3 that a lame man was brought to sit daily by the beautiful gate, which was at the entrance to the court of men. So they were allowed to go that far. It's likely then that Jesus brought them with him past the beautiful gate to the inner temple and healed them right there in his Father's house. So, once again, the religious leaders were bent out of shape about the form while missing the substance, the joy, the sign right before their eyes. Jesus was the Messiah with the power to save. The chief priests and scribes were also angry at the kids who followed Jesus right into the temple, still singing, "Hosanna to the Son of David." The priests and scribes accused our Lord, "Do you hear what these are saying?" Their question was a trap, daring Jesus to answer. Something like, "Yes, and they are right." But instead, the Lord stung them with scripture. They should have been able to quote chapter and verse. He did it to humble them, but they would not be humbled. Jesus asked, "Have you never read? Out of the mouths of infants and nursing babes, you have prepared praise for yourself." And that's our final Old Testament connection from Psalm 8. Read the fuller version, and you'll find out that it's not just a wonderful thing to hear the children sing. Psalm 8 tells us God ordained the children to sing and speak the truth against God's enemies as a bulwark and a strengthened fortress against God's enemies. Wow. And that's what the children did. They spoke the truth. Then Jesus left them and went to Bethany, left the chief priests and the scribes still angry. But dear people, we rejoice. Let's wave those palms at home. Hosanna to the one who comes to save us. We rejoice, for this is the moment that everything God has promised was coming to fulfillment. When the deliverance he brings became clear this holy week, when we see the passion of our Lord as he removes every last barrier separating us from God. Follow him with deepest reverence, gratitude, and awe. And when we are once again able to worship together in this house of prayer, listening to our children sing, let's remember Psalm 8. And when we come right up to the altar for communion, we'll think how Jesus opened the way. A pastor wrote, "God's majesty visits our frailty and exalts the humble to royalty." Jesus didn't just cleanse the temple. He has become the new temple, and his risen spirit dwells in us, desires to make us his living temple. You mean so much to God. Jesus healed the lame and the blind, gathered the children to him, welcomed the alien, cared for the widow, the poor, the outcast, and he cares for you. That's the gospel for us this day. In a day and a time when people are afraid and alone, and the signature of this pandemic will always be the isolation and separation it brought. But the Lord who tears down all the barriers will knock down the barrier of this pandemic too. For now, beloved of God, look, your Savior comes, riding in majesty, bringing his kingdom to you. Amen.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, I wouldn't trade it for anything. My brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always tell scars. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. So I'm thankful for
creation. We neglect to care for your creation. Quiet the earth where it trembles and shakes. Restore it to health and wholeness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of wisdom, we are living in times of uncertainty and endless change. Guide the decisions of our local, state, and national leaders. Help them turn to you in wisdom. Give them courage amid the turmoil. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of comfort, so many are hurting and scared and need you. We pray for those who need your special care, for Paul Strand, Miriam Ryan, Elizabeth Crow, Chuck Pogolis, Lynn Olson, Beverly Blado, Bree Hensel's mother, Susan, Carla Aldry's nephew, Dan, Doreen Mayer's granddaughter, Jessica, Mary Olson's mother, Velva, for all the elderly in nursing homes, for those who are isolated from loved ones, and for those who are hurting, and for those who we name before you now. Heal the wounded, comfort the dying. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing, we pray for those on the front lines of the pandemic. We are grateful for their unwavering service. Keep them safe and healthy. Give them wisdom as they care for our most vulnerable. Help them stay clear-minded in the midst of surrounding anxiety. Give them compassion for all. Lord, help us know your heart. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of eternal life, when we slow down, we are mindful of our one precious life. When we breathe our last, you raise us to eternal life. We pray for all who have passed into your eternal care. We pray for Kevin and Shelley Wasti and their family on the death of Kevin's mother, Doris. Lord, let not our hearts be troubled. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. According to your steadfast love, O God, hear all these prayers as we commend them to you through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Whole realm of nature
bless your name.
Go in peace, remember the poor. Thanks be to God.